Okay, we'll do the prayers all together. Om Sada Shiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Param Saraswati Namastubhyam
वरदे कामरूपिणि विद्यारम्भं करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा
ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु वासुदेवेन्द्र योगींद्रम् नत्वा ज्ञानप्रदं मुमुक्षूणाय ओम नमः शिवाय।
ओम नमः शिवाय।
ओके, सो आई हैव म्यूटेड एवरीबॉडी, यू कैन अनम्यूट व्हेन यू वांट टू से समथिंग। राइट, सो लास्ट क्लास वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट व्हिच टॉपिक?
सूक्ष्म
शरीर। Right, we were talking about Sukshma Shariram. And which part?
We had finished the Antahkaranam.
We finished Antahkaranam and it comes under the components of Sukshma Shariram. Right, the various components of Sukshma Shariram. And how many components are there?
The Pancha Gyanendriyas, Kamendriyas, the Pancha Prana and Antahkaranam.
Total
17 as in the text, and otherwise 19 if we add the chitta ahankar.
Yes, very good. And which are the pancha gnanendriyas?
The sense organs, the eyes, ears, nose, skin and tongue.
Yes, and in Sanskrit?
Shrotam, Shurasam, Dak, Chakshu, Rasanam,
Chakshu, Rasam and Ghrana.
Yes. Shrotram, Tvak, Chakshu, Rasanam and Ghranam. Okay, and then we have the Karmendriyas, which are the organs of action. They are predisposed to activity, the exit gates, you can say. If sense organs are the entrance gates, then Karmendriyas are like the exit gates. And which are those five?
The mouth, hands, feet, the organ of evacuation and organ of reproduction.
Yes, Sanskrit?
Vatpani, Padpayu and Upastha.
Yes, very good. And then Pancha Prana. So these are which five?
The
Vyana.
Yes. Okay, Prana, Vyana, Udana, Samana. Okay, five of those. Then we have the Antahkarana, which was the inner instrument, which is basically the mind, and then four aspects of the mind. What are the four?
The Mana, Buddhi, Chitta, Ahankara.
Yes. The Mana is the oscillating or the emotional faculty of the mind. Buddhi is the intellectual or decisive faculty. Ahankara is the identification faculty. And Chitta is the memory faculty. Okay. So we saw Sukshma Shariram. And what is left after Sukshma Shariram? in the sharira trayam?
The karana sharira, the causal body.
Yes, the causal body, the karana shariram, is what we will be seeing today. Okay, so we will just read this. Karana shariram kim?
Karana shariram kim?
Anirvachya.
Anirvachya.
Anadya vidya rupam.
Anadya vidya rupam.
Shariratvayasya.
Shariratvayasya.
Karana matram.
Karana matram.
Satswarupajnanam.
Satswarupajnanam.
Nirvikalpakarupam.
Nirvikalpakarupam.
Yadasti.
Yadasti.
Tatkarana shariram.
Tatkarana shariram.
So now we will see what is karana shariram. And the student has asked the question, karana shariram kim? Kim means what? So he is asking, what is karana shariram? And this word karana shariram, if you remember, it was mentioned when the author spoke about shariratrayam. He said the atma is different from shariratrayam. And then he said, shariratrayam, there are three, right? Sthula, sukshma, and karana shariram. So till now we have discussed sthula and sukshma, and now karana shariram is left. And that is what we are going to see. So we are not going to see the Sanskrit verse right away. We will come back to this. First, we will see the four aspects. Okay, the four aspects, if you remember, condition, cause, nature, and function. That we will see, like how we saw in the previous two, and then we will come back to this. Okay, so in this one, we will just start with function first. Okay, we're not going to see the condition first. We will see the function first, then we will see the others. Now, in physics, if you remember your school days, there is a law called the law of conservation of mass and energy. Law of conservation of mass and energy. Anyone knows what this law states?
Energy is neither be created nor destroyed.
Matter is neither created nor destroyed. It only changes form from one to the other.
So, matter and energy cannot be created and cannot be destroyed. They can only change from one to the other, right? So, just think about it for a moment. You don't need physics to tell you this, but you just think for a moment. Is there anything that you have seen that can be absolutely destroyed? You just think. For example, take a chair, okay? Suppose you want to destroy the chair. What do you do? Suppose you break it down with a hammer. Is that destruction of the chair? No, because the wood pieces are still there. Then you say, I want to destroy this wood. So suppose you set it on fire. Is that also absolute destruction? Not really, because some part of the wood gets converted into energy as fire and some part of the wood becomes ash, right? And you can go on trying, but finally you will realize that you cannot at all totally destroy something. And in the same way, you cannot totally create something either. Okay. So some people say that, you know, but yeah, it becomes invisible. It becomes, you know, I can't see it anymore. For example, if I take water and I heat the water and the water has now gone, it is as though destroyed, but really, is it destroyed? What happens to water when you heat it?
It vaporizes.
It vaporizes. And in other words, it becomes gaseous vapor.
Gas.
It is in the gaseous form. It is not destroyed, right? This is very important to understand that there can never be destruction and there can never be absolute creation. absolute creation and destruction are not at all possible. According to physics also, according to Shastra also, and if you look around you, you will also realize this yourself. Just take a moment and try to think of anything that can be destroyed. And you will see that it is not possible. What is possible is merely transformation. Okay, from one form to another form. And that is why we have Einstein's very famous equation, E is equal to mc square. E stands for energy, m stands for mass, c is the speed of light. So basically, energy and matter are interchangeable forms of each other. Okay, they are not two different things, they are just interchangeable forms of each other. They even say that what we call matter is nothing but tightly packed energy, compactly packed energy in a very dense form is what we call as matter. And the two are not different. They are actually connected by this equation E is equal to mc square. And you know, physics is quite interesting when you go down that road, because what looks like a wall in front of me, you just look at the wall, it appears solid, right? And when you go a little deeper into the wall, what do they say? They say there are molecules and atoms. You go deeper into the atom, they say it's like 90% empty space and about 10% of electrons, protons, and neutrons. Suppose you try to go deeper into these subatomic particles. They say it is just energy in motion. Right now they're talking about quarks and leptons and all these things, but these things are invisible, practically, you know, almost not detectable, definitely not detectable to our senses, right? They use equations and sophisticated instruments to just come up with these ideas. But actually these subatomic particles are totally non-substantial, right? They are basically energy. So there is a very deep connection there, energy and matter. And Shastra also says this agrees with this law of conservation of mass and energy, that E is equal to mc square. They cannot be destroyed and cannot be created. So in the same way, like how I explained to you, nothing can be destroyed. Even, you know, on death, when the body is burnt or buried, it only undergoes a transformation into some other state. It is not an absolute destruction of the body. So in the way it cannot be destroyed, can anything be created? Not really, right? Whatever we call creation, we are just taking some things, aggregating them, right? And then we're telling this is a new thing. Absolute creation, creating something out of nothing, is not at all possible. So there's a nice joke that I heard regarding this. So it seems there are a group of genetic scientists, and they all go to God and they tell him, God, listen, we have learned how to create a human baby out of nothing. Okay, and God is very impressed and he says, oh, this is amazing, let's go see it. And so they go, and so the scientists, they take some soil, you know, some mud, and then they do some science on it, something, and finally they are able to produce a human baby out of that. Okay, and they show it to God, like, look, we made a human baby out of this. And then God is like, yeah, okay, this is all great, but next time get your own soil. Okay, so basically the idea is that there cannot be, you know, something created from totally nothing. There has to be some base, and then a transformation happens, which is what we call as creation. So this is the idea that nothing is created and nothing is destroyed. Now with this, keeping this idea in your mind, why do we talk about Srishti and Pralayam in Shastra? Shastra says that there is something called Srishti and there is something called Pralayam. If creation and destruction are not possible, why is there or how can there be srishti and pralayam? And now remember that Shastra can never contradict itself. Shastra cannot say that on one side, you know, that law of conservation also is there and also Srishti and Pralayam, cosmic creation and cosmic dissolution is also there. It cannot say both these statements. Shastra cannot contradict itself. Any idea why there can be Srishti, Pralayam and law of conservation?
It just appears so. It just appears so.
Okay. So then what is actually happening? If that is the appearance, then what is the actual thing happening?
Medhaji, when the Pralayam happens, the energy is in its dormant state. And then when Srishti happens, then it starts moving or it starts expanding.
Okay. You've got the idea, right? So what we call Srishti and Pralayam are not absolute creation and destruction. Srishti and Pralayam are also transformation from one state to another state. Okay. And those two states we call as Vyakta and Avyakta. Okay. This is important. The meaning of the word Vyakta means manifest. Avyakta means unmanifest. Manifest. The meaning of the word manifest is it becomes apparent to the senses. And the meaning of the word unmanifest is that it is not available or apparent to your senses. So we'll take the water example again. When you heat the water, it becomes vapor, steam, right? Water is Vyakta. It is available to your senses, but the steam is not available to your senses. It is avyakta, right? But does that mean that water has been destroyed? It has merely changed, right? It has merely transformed into avyakta. Now this is what is happening with the universe. So the universe also transforms from Vyakta to Avyakta and then back to Vyakta and so on eternally. Okay. In other words, the universe is always there. There is never a time when the universe is not there. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. So there is never a time when the universe is not there. The universe is always there. And in fact, Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, 28th verse says, Avyakta dini bhutani vyakta madhyani bharata avyakta nidanan yeva tatra ka paridevana. So Krishna says there that there is avyakta state. From the avyakta state, this so-called creation happens. In other words, transformation into this Vyakta or manifest state. What you see around you right now, the whole creation, this is Vyakta, manifest. Why? Because you can see it. It is available to your senses, right? So this is called Vyakta or manifest state. Then at Pralayam, what happens is it goes back to a Vyakta state. It goes back to that unmanifest or potential state. Okay. Then in the next cycle of Srishti, again it comes back to Vyakta. Then at next Pralayam, again back to Avyakta. And so on. Okay. So basically Krishna says that this Vyakta-Avyakta cycle keeps on happening. In other words, the universe is always there. There is never a time when it is not there. So what is there to cry about? When we talk about death, there is really no destruction. So is there anything to cry about? If nothing is gone, then why to cry? Right? So that is the idea. What we call Srishti is nothing but a transformation from Vyakta to Avyakta. And what we call Pralayam is from Avyakta to Vyakta. Okay? Is this clear, this idea?
Yes.
Yes. So these are forms of kinetic and potential energies, Medhaji?
It's similar to kinetic and potential energy, but Avyakta cannot be said to be energy. Energy is finally matter only. It is still very much in the Vyakta, you know, state.
Okay.
You can just call it potential. Avyakta can be called as potential. But remember, E is equal to mc square. So, this is about Srishti and Pralayam. Now, why is this relevant to Karana Shariram? It is because this Karana Shariram is what exists after Pralayam. So, the Sukshma and Sthula Shariram need to have a seed form, a potential form, right? They cannot be totally destroyed. If they are totally destroyed, then it cannot exist in the next Srishti, right? So they have to exist in a potential or a seed form. And that seed is what is called as Karana Shariram. It's like, you know, the tree has a seed, right? So in the seed, you can't make out that there is a tree or there are leaves or all these things. But the information of that tree is contained in that seed. So right now, even though the tree is not available, the information for that tree is available in the seed. So since nothing can be destroyed and nothing can be created, it applies even to the Sukshma Sharira and even to the Sthula Sharira, right? They have to exist in some potential form. And that potential form is called as Karana Shariram. It is the seed or the potential for the other two. It is the seed also, and it is the dissolution ground also. So at Pralayam, this Sukshma Shariram resolves into Karana Shariram. And at the next Rishti, again, from this Karana Shariram is born the Sukshma Shariram. And then, of course, the cycle continues. Okay? It is the ultimate seed, you can say.
And then, yeah. The meaning of Karana is what here?
The meaning of Karana is cause.
Cause only, okay.
So Karana Shariram is causal body.
Mm.
Okay, now be careful. Many people read in English as casual body. It is not casual, it is causal.
Mm.
Causal means the cause, Karana.
So you can also compare it to a memory card or a memory chip. Karana Shariram is like it contains all of the essence of many sthula shariram, sukshma sharirams.
Yes, in a way. It is the potential, or it contains the information.
Mm-hmm.
So not exactly a storage device, but yeah, maybe you could say so.
Say like, why I mean to ask you is, we take so many different janmas, and all of that janmas, samskaras or whatever, the memory of it is stored in Karana Shariram.
Yes. The potential, yes, the potential or the information is stored in Karanam.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thank you.
So this is the function of Karana Shariram, that it acts, as you say, like a storage device. Okay. It acts as the potential, the seed or the source of these other two bodies. That is the function. Now, the next thing is the condition. What is the condition of the karana shariram? It exists in an undifferentiated state. Now, this word undifferentiated is important. So, when you see the seed of a tree, can you see individual leaves and branches and flowers and all that?
No.
Even if you break the seed, can you see all that?
No, it's genetically coded.
It is there, but it is in an undifferentiated form. You understand? The information is available in the seed, right? For the leaves and the flowers and all these things. The information is there, but it is in an undifferentiated state. You cannot make out individual leaves. You cannot make out individual flowers. So, karana shariram also exists in the same way, in an undifferentiated form. You cannot make out individualities, or you cannot make out differences between the different things. So when it exists in the karana shariram state after pralayam, there is no my karana shariram, your karana shariram. These things don't exist. Why? Because it is undifferentiated. Just like how you cannot make out this leaf and that leaf in the tree, in the same way, in the karana shariram state, you cannot make out mine and yours. It is all undifferentiated. The entire universal potential exists in an undifferentiated way. Okay? All the jivas of the whole universe exist in that way, in that undifferentiated state. Clear? So this is the condition. It is without any differences. You cannot distinguish, cannot differentiate anything.
So there is only one karana sharira for all, for everything, for everybody.
In the pralayam state, it is one thing.
Okay.
It is like asking, it's like asking, are there many leaves in the tree or are there many leaves in the seed kind of thing. It's difficult to visualize. When the tree is available, then there are different leaves and it makes sense to have different leaves. But when only the seed is there, can you say that, is it only one leaf?
No.
Like that. Okay, so at this level, when the manifestation is there, when creation is going on, the individual differences become obvious and apparent. And at this level, it makes sense also to have that. But in that state, it is, you can't say it is not there, but at the same time, you cannot make out the differences.
Medhaji, may I interrupt? Yeah, the example you gave for the seed, actually for different trees, we have different.
Yeah, we will take just one seed and one tree for the sake of the example. Every example is limited, okay? If you dig deeper into the example, you'll find loopholes. So take all examples in a limited context only. So just one tree and its own seed that it is born out of. So just to help you understand, if I directly tell undifferentiated, it's difficult to imagine or visualize. Whereas with the tree and seed, it helps you a little bit to get the idea.
Thank you.
Okay, so the condition of the karana shariram is that it is undifferentiated. The function is that it is the seed or the potential for the other two bodies. The condition is undifferentiated. Now we come to the third aspect, which is the nature. Now, when everything is in a totally undifferentiated state, there are no differences, right? So in a state like this, is knowledge possible? Is it possible to know about anything?
No.
Okay, and it need not be knowledge of like, you know, jnanam, atma jnanam. I'm talking just regular knowledge. If you just look at a pen, you have knowledge about the pen, right? Now, is knowledge of anything at all possible when it is in an undifferentiated state? And explain why also.
Yes, ma'am. Medha ji,
yeah.
That is the state when we can grasp a lot because we are completely ignorant. Whatever you imbibe, it gets impregnated. Am I right or wrong? I don't know.
Okay, one more chance.
A kind of diffusion is required for you to understand something. If you are mm-hmm. completely fused with that thing, you become one with that and you can't differentiate. So there is a kind of theory in everything that says there is an observer and something he is observing.
Yes.
So if you take it in a condensed form, he will become one with that. And in a pure state, what you are referring, it's almost impossible for him to understand what he is doing or grasp, observe what he is taking.
Okay, so the answer is in the right track, although we don't use those exact words. So when you talk about an undifferentiated state, it means there is no duality, right? And for knowledge, duality is always required. Two things must be there. The object to be known and the one who knows that object. Two things must be there. And also the equipment for that knowledge, the infrastructure to know anything must be there, right? So right now, if I hold a pen in my hand, the pen is one object. I am the one who knows the pen. And how do I know the pen? With the help of my sense organs and my mind, right? Now in the undifferentiated state, none of these are available, right? There is no subject-object duality. There is no infrastructure for knowledge. And so when this is the case, it is no knowledge is possible. And so it is a state of total ignorance, a state of blanket ignorance. It is not possible to know anything. It is not even possible to know that I don't know. Okay. You understand this? The knower and known duality that exists, that is not there. So, for example, if we come to our tree and seed example, if there are two leaves, and suppose, you know, the leaves have their own life, it is possible for one leaf to know the other leaf, only when two leaves are there. But in the seed, the two leaves don't even exist as leaves, right? They exist as potential only. So in that state, how is it possible for one leaf to know the other leaf? Not possible. And so it is a state of total ignorance. Blanket ignorance.
Medha ji, can this be referred to shunya, what they call?
No, we don't call it shunya.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, so in this state,
can I interrupt?
Yes.
What is the evidence that it exists?
Okay, we'll come to that.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So in this state, there is nothing to know and nothing with which to know. Okay, and there's no, equipment for the knower also to know. Now, this state we call as Ajnanam, Sat Swarupa Ajnanam. When there is total ignorance, there is obviously ignorance of my real nature also. So it is blanket ignorance. We call it as Ajnanam. Now, there is something interesting at this point. So you all have heard of the Big Bang Theory, I'm sure. Do you know what the state before Big Bang happened, the state of existence, do you know what it is called as? Just before Big Bang, they say the universe existed as dash. That word, anyone? they say in the Big Bang Theory that the universe before its existence existed as a singularity. This is a physics word. They use the word singularity. Singularity means no duality, right? No two things. And also Big Bang Theory says that the time before Big Bang happened, it is a state of no information. So scientists have tried a lot to find out what was the state of information before, you know, Big Bang happened, before the universe was created. And they say it is a state of no information. Does this sound familiar?
Yes.
Ajnanam.
It is Ajnanam. Yes. It is
Advaita.
Undifferentiated, because they say singularity, undifferentiated. And if you read a little more on the Big Bang and what exists before the Big Bang, you'll find a lot of similarities to Karana Shariram. Okay. So proof of Karana Shariram, there is no direct proof as such. So first is physics is, seems to be headed in the same direction. So secondly, Shastra tells us this, right? And Shastra, if you remember, is a Pramanam. The way you trust your eyes to reveal something to you, when Shastra reveals something to you, you apply the same trust there. And thirdly, by your own common sense, you know that nothing can be totally created or nothing can be totally destroyed. So the question comes, where does it all go? And this is the answer. From your own observation, you can become aware of the fact that there cannot be total destruction. And so there must be some answer to that, some resolution to that idea, right? And so this is that answer. So that is the answer to the question, what is the proof for Karanam? There is no direct proof as such. You cannot go there and poke it and feel it. Okay. But this is the idea. You can inferentially get it. And of course, Shastra, through as a Pramanam, reveals this to us. So this state of total ignorance, you know, Shastra says that even if scientists try to find out information about what was there before Big Bang, they will not find it because it is a state of no information. It is like breaking open the seed and trying to find out the leaves. Even if you do that, it's not possible. Even if you use all your scientific instruments, you cannot find the leaves of the tree in the seed, right? So it is a state of no information, Ajnanam. Right, so this is about the nature of Karana Shariram. Then the question comes, what is the cause? The fourth point, if you remember, it is function, condition, nature, and cause. What is the cause of Karana Shariram? Now, the question is itself wrong. Okay, there cannot be a question, what is the cause of Karana Shariram? Because Karana Shariram is itself the cause. It has no further cause. So in other words, it is the causeless cause. It is the cause of the other two bodies and it itself has no further cause. Okay, and they also say it is the beginningless cause. Now this is an idea that takes some time to grasp because all of us have been educated to think in a linear way. We want a beginning, we want an end, and it's a straight line in between, linear thinking. But Shastra never encourages linear thinking. It encourages circular thinking. There is never any beginning. There is never any end. This goes on eternally. So if you ask, when was the first Srishti? When was the first creation? It is a wrong question because there is no first creation. Creation happens cyclically, eternally. It goes on forever. When something goes on forever, there is no first and there is no last. Right? If you look at a circle and if you ask, where is the beginning of this circle? You can't answer that, right? Wherever you put your finger, that is the beginning, that is the end, that can be everything. But it goes on all the time. So So this is the idea, this eternal thinking, this circular thinking, this we have to slowly start cultivating. So these questions keep coming up. When was the first Srishti? Where did it all start? You know, how did the first cause come? And all these, the first, whenever that word comes, first thing, when did the first thing happen? Then you have to remember circular thinking. Okay, so this Karana Shariram is the causeless cause, the beginningless, the causeless cause. This Karanam is not a product of anything. Okay, so in Sanskrit we say Karanam and Karyam. There is a cause and there is a product. Karanam, Karyam. But this Karanam, it is not the Karyam of anything. It is not a product of anything. It is itself the cause. Okay. And it is beginningless, which we called as anadi. Cyclical anadi. And it is, okay. And then there are many technical words for this Karana Shariram. We use many words to talk about Karana Shariram. Sometimes we call it Maya. Sometimes we call it Avyaktam. Sometimes we call it Shakti. Sometimes we call it Prakriti. Sometimes we call it Moola Avidya. Sometimes we call it Anirvachya. Okay, many, many words describing and talking about this same thing. Okay, so if multiple words start coming up, don't get confused. It is all coming back to the same idea. Okay. And remember that this Karana Shariram is also Anatma. It's easy to confuse this idea of Karana Shariram with Atma because, you know, undifferentiated, total ignorance, blah, blah, blah. It's easy to imagine that this must be Atma, but this is also not Atma. It is very much Anatma. And that is why it is part of Shariratrayam. Okay. So this is the idea. Now at this point, you may be thinking, how do you experience this Karana Shariram? How do I, you know, get to know? Now you can't take a hammer and go and try to destroy the whole world and then say, I will experience Karana Shariram, right? So is there some way to understand this better? Now there is actually a way and we have all experienced it. Any guesses?
Is it the deep sleep state?
Yes. The deep sleep state. Okay. The deep sleep
state. Can we fall sick?
No, the deep sleep state. When you go into deep sleep, it is a small taste or a sample of Karana Shariram. What happens in deep sleep state? The mind is resolved, the sense organs are resolved. It is a state of undifferentiation. In your mind, there is no experience. Right? But when you wake up, you can say, I had a good sleep. So it is not nothingness either. How do you know you had a good sleep if it was total nothingness? But when you are sleeping, you can't say that. You can't say, I am sleeping now. You can only say, I slept well. Right? So this state of deep sleep is a small taste of Karana Shariram. Okay? It is your own private pralayam, mini pralayam. And there's nothing to worry about when you go to sleep because you wake up, right, in the morning. So that's why Krishna says, Tatraka Paridevana, what is there to grieve when Srishti and pralayam happen? Just like how we don't cry when we go to sleep or when we wake up. Same concept. Okay.
May that be one question.
Yeah.
So when you say the cause is, it is the beginningless, causeless cause, and you told us how to think in a circular way. So how can you connect this with Srishti and Pralaya?
Pralayam is when this, it resolves into the Karana Shariram state.
Okay. So the circle is in that Karana Shariram state?
The circle is the Srishti Pralayam, Srishti Pralayam, Srishti Pralayam.
Okay, okay.
It goes on infinitely. Okay. And okay. So the question, when was the first Srishti, cannot come up.
In this.
because it is eternal, always happening.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have discussed that Karana Shariram is the seed of Sukshma Shariram and Stula Shariram. Right? And yeah. In general, we read cause is something the vice of we do. Why we are doing this? A cause. So my question is, people generally ask what's the meaning of life, man's search for meaning and all. So is it related to this Karana Shariram?
No, this is not that cause. Here we are talking about cause and effect.
Okay.
Okay, so that is different.
Okay, understood.
Okay, so what you are talking about is the reason for something. We are talking about the cause and effect. If I ask you what is the cause of your body, the answer should be the five elements. That is the cause. The effect of the five elements is, one of the effects is the body, the human body, right? Like that. When you resolve something, what you get, that is the cause. Not the reason. Okay.
I'm interrupting again. When you say, I couldn't digest a little bit, so that's why I'm asking. As you said, Karana Shariram, that is the one thing, undifferentiated, and then Pralayam and Srishti. So when we use this word Pralaya or Srishti, is it happening every day, every moment, or like in a big manner, like the time we cannot find out, or limitless time kind of thing? Because if it is first one, so my next question comes there, if it is not the first one, that means moment to moment, then again probably I'm going back to my first question, that every jiva is not every jiva, I mean many jivas are living, or sthula shariram is being dead, so that time basically there this karana shariram is living with the sthula shariram. I mean, it's not getting dead, but it is existing. So if all the karana shariram is a karana shariram, is one karana shariram, undifferentiated, so is it existing every moment? Because at least one someone is dying every moment. So I'm not sure if I could put my question proper manner.
So when we say Srishti and Pralayam, we are talking at cosmic level, like Big Bang theory level. It is a cosmic level. So Pralayam is at the cosmic level. But as you are aware, every moment we do have changing situations. There is small scale so-called creation and destruction happening, small scale transformation also happening. But with jivas, at Pralayam, all the sukshma shariras resolve into karanam. So at death, the sukshma shariram just travels and picks up a new body. Many of them don't immediately get a body, so they are said to kind of be in waiting.
Okay.
And then they get a
So that means, suppose I am dying at this moment, or like suppose the next moment I'm dead. So I also have a karana shariram, right?
Yes.
So now is it not a pralaya, like, because that, so then where it is now existing? So some form of karana shariram is there?
No, your sukshma is in waiting now for the next body, right? So when it gets the next body, it will occupy the next body. And when pralayam happens at the totality level, when pralayam happens, all of them will resolve back to karanam.
Okay, so when someone is dying, there is no question of karana shariram. It is basically sukshma and sthula.
Yes.
Sthula is dying and sukshma is living.
Yes, when vyakta prapancha is there, when this manifest creation is there, that time we talk only in terms of sukshma and sthula.
Okay.
It is like when the tree is there, then you don't talk about the seed, right, anymore.
Okay.
But when The problem with the tree and seed example is that it's a one-way traffic, you know. Seed becomes tree, but you can't imagine that same tree becoming the same seed. But here that is what is kind of happening.
Thank you.
So when that tree is there, you don't really talk about its own seed. But when the seed is there, you can't talk about its leaves and other things. When tree is there, you can talk about this leaf and that flower and all those things. So those are the terms we use.
Veda ji.
Yeah.
We've been talking of the jiva traveling after the body drops and travels and gets into another body. So that another body was without the jiva till then.
The other body was, finally, what is a body? It is an aggregation of elements, aggregation of some matter come together in a particular way. And then when the sukshma sharira occupies that body, it becomes alive, sentient, what we call, right?
Okay.
See, the difference between a dead body and a living body is what? The presence of this sukshma shariram.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The difference between, you know, a living body and a stone is also sukshma sharira. Stone is just matter. Your body is also just matter. But why does your body think and the stone not think? Sukshma shariram. That's the answer. Okay, because of the presence of the sukshma shariram. So when you say that, you know, then the body is without sukshma shariram, first of all, there is no body because you just have to put together those elements and create that body, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if there's no sukshma shariram, it's as good as a stone.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Medhaji, one more question. Sorry for asking so many questions today. So is it better for us to understand that Karana Shariram is this one big, say, ball into which Sukshma Shariram, Shariras go in and then come out, go in and then come out? So should we consider it that way? Is it better for us to understand that way?
At the beginning level, maybe it's okay for a visualization, maybe, but eventually you have to evolve out of that idea. When you talk about, okay, I'll tell you about what Big Bang theory says. So when they talk about singularity, most people imagine it like a point in space, right? Generally, this is a idea that comes up, that there's a dot and that is the singularity and this thing. But the thing is, before the Big Bang theory, space and time itself did not exist.
Hmm.
Space itself was not there. The space was created as the Big Bang happened. And for the human mind, it is very difficult to conceive of a dimensionless entity, a formless, dimensionless, spaceless, timeless entity. It's very hard for us to visualize and come to terms with these ideas. But that is what singularity means. They say that it is a dimensionless entity, which is finally avyakta only, what we are talking about. But it's very difficult to imagine. But in the beginning, if it helps you, you can visualize that. But know that you have to slowly evolve out of that idea.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. So we will just see the verse now. We have covered Karana Shariram and we will see the verse. So the student has asked Karana Shariram Kim, what is Karana Shariram? And then there are word breakups here. Anirvachya, Anadi Avidya, Rupam. So Anirvachya. Anirvachya means that which cannot be described. The technical meaning is that which cannot be categorically stated as either this or either that. It cannot be, categorically stated, cannot be logically divided as either this or either that. It is kind of not possible to put into words, kind of non-explainable. So he says, Karana Shariram is Anirvachya. kind of non-explainable, cannot be categorically put anywhere. Then he says, anadi. This word breaks here is anadi. Anadi means beginningless. So the circular concept that we discussed, anadi. Then avidya. Now the word avidya is generally translated as ignorance. Okay, but here we are not talking about just regular ignorance. I don't know something and that is ignorance. Not that, okay. Here we are talking about moola avidya. Is my voice clear? There's some disturbance outside, but I can't do anything about it.
Yeah, very clear.
Okay, fine. So we are talking about moola avidya. Okay, the fundamental ignorance. When it is a state of non-differentiation, then knowledge is not at all possible, right? Moola avidya. The very fundamental root ignorance. There is another meaning for the word avidya, a technical meaning. It means that which has no existence of its own. Swataha na vidyate iti avidya. That which has no substantiality or existence of its own. In other words, it is mithya. If you remember, mithya we said is dependent existence. So that which has no independent existence, that is also called as avidya. So this karana shariram is, it is anirvachya, it is anadi, and it is avidya. Rupam means of the form of. So it is of the form of these things. Then, sharira dvayasya. Dvaya. This dvaya means two. Sharira dvayasya means two bodies. Now, which two bodies? Obviously, the other two, right? Sukshma and sthula. So the other two bodies. And what is it to the other two bodies? Karana matram. Karanam means cause. Matram means indeed or only. So its function is to be the cause of the other two bodies only. That is the function. Then he says it is sat swarupa agnanam. Agnanam, we said, state of total ignorance, blanket ignorance, right? And it is a state of not knowing, and that includes even sat swarupa. My own real nature is also not known. So sat swarupa agnanam. Then nirvikalpaka rupam. Again, the word rupam means of the form of. And what is the it of the form of? Nirvikalpaka. Vikalpa means differences. Nirvikalpa means non-differences, no differences. So it is undifferentiated state. The word nirvikalpaka rupam is just Sanskrit for undifferentiated state. Okay. Yad asti is yat plus asti, which means the one that is like this, tat, that. So the one that is like this, that is karana shariram. So he gives the description and he says the one that has all these descriptions, that is called as karana shariram. And what are those descriptions? Anirvachya, non, you know, definable, anadi, beginningless, avidya, which is in a way mithya, sharira dvayasya karanam, the cause of the other two bodies, and it is agnanam, total ignorance, nirvikalpaka, non-differentiated, and the one that has all these qualities, that is called as karana shariram. Okay, so this is the author's answer to the question, what is karana shariram? And we saw all these words when we discussed previously. Yeah, any questions? With this, we have completed Sharira Trayam. And next class, we will be starting Avastha Trayam.
Medhaji, can you please repeat once more the other words which you used for Karana Sharira, like Maya, Avyaktam, Shakti?
Yeah, so Maya, Avyakta, शक्ति प्रकृति मूल अविद्या अनिर्वाच्य
And you also said anatma.
Yes, it is okay. Finally anatma also.
And mithya?
Mithya also. Karana sharira at samashti level or vyashti level? Karana sharira is, when we talk about pralayam, it can only be at the samashti level, the totality. It cannot be at the individual level. For all intents and purposes, it is, you know, only at the totality level. Only when we're talking about individual karmas and those things, that is when the, you know, the individuality plays any role of when karana shariram plays any role, you know, for the sake of the individual, the role exists only when creation is happening and only when we're talking about karmas and other things. So that was for a question that had come up on the chat. Yeah, that's a advanced level answer. So it's okay if you did not understand it. Okay.
Yes.
So we will stop for the day. We can end with the prayers. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Shanti 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 Hari Om Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om Om Namah Shivaya Om Tat Sat.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thanks a lot, Medhaji.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Medhaji.
Thank you.